thank you very much for having me, to Hui, for inviting me. So this is a paper about unintended consequences, but not of fiscal stimulus. It's unintended consequences of regulation. So, I mean, the current environment seems like a good environment to ask this question in. After the U.S. financial crisis, there's been a big push towards regulating the banking sector more, both in terms of higher capital requirements and in terms of more stringent liquidity requirements. So this is basically going to be a paper that develops a theory of how regulation, in particular liquidity regulation, could go wrong with an application to China. So we're basically going to build a framework that has three main ingredients. So the first two are kind of things that you would find in other kind of banking papers. The last one is something that hasn't really been modeled maybe as seriously as it should. So we're gonna have a model that has kind of heterogeneity in the cross-section of banks. So we're gonna consider both big and small banks. There's gonna be an interbank market where banks that have insufficient liquidity borrow from banks that have surplus liquidity. Prices on this market are gonna be endogenous, so this is important when it interacts with the different sizes of the banks. And the last thing is this idea of off-balance sheet vehicles. So this is, I mean, I guess a little bit in response to Atif's question of on the previous paper, we think of these more like the asset-backed commercial paper conduits in that they're basically gonna finance themselves shorter term than the assets they invest in, and they offer either implicit guarantees of the type that Jigo was talking about or literally backup lines of credit to the conduits in the same way that we saw in the crisis. So these off-balance sheet vehicles are only gonna be, they're essentially there to capture accounting maneuvers that banks can use to make their legally use, to make their balance sheets more favorable from the perspective of the regulator without actually changing the nature of their activities. So basically what we're gonna show is if you set up a fairly simple model with these three ingredients, you can get liquidity regulation having exactly the opposite of its intended effect. So usually when a regulator comes in and puts in a liquidity minimum, the idea is to have the banks hold more assets that kind of can be converted into cash very easily and less long-term lending. We're gonna show that if you impose minimum liquidity standards in a world that has these three features, you're actually gonna get the opposite. You're gonna get an increase in credit relative to savings as opposed to a decrease in credit relative to savings. And we're gonna argue that this is applicable to China. So, I mean, I don't need to motivate the fact that China's had a huge credit boom over the past decade or so. So we're gonna use our model to think about how much can this mechanism, as opposed to other stories related to fiscal stimulus, explain the rise of credit in China, which is basically the increasing, from the supply side, so an increasing intensity of banks in their willingness to lend. And we're gonna get that about a third of China's credit boom can be explained as the unintended effect of tighter liquidity regulation. So I'm really glad Wei put some notation up, because I'm gonna take you through some notation. So I'll try to make this as painless as possible. But just to give you a sense of the type of ingredients we have in this world, so we're gonna think of a bank that divides its activities. On the liability side, it's gonna be raised in two forms. So you're gonna have your traditional deposits, which will be booked on balance sheet, and then some other category, which is deposit-like, so we're gonna call them deposit-like products. The key feature of these deposit-like products is that they can be moved off balance sheet, and they can also offer higher interest rates than traditional deposits. Now, we're gonna differ a little bit from the previous paper that you saw in the sense that you only really need to move off balance sheet if you want to make your loan to deposit ratio look favorable. So if it's just about offering higher interest rates to savers, you can offer these deposit-like products on balance sheet. In the context of China, let's call it a WMP. A WMP, as long as it's not called a deposit, can offer a higher interest rate than traditional deposits, even on balance sheet. So the spread is kind of on 30 to 90 basis points over the sample relative to traditional deposits. So you don't need off-balance sheet vehicles to offer higher interest products. You do, however, need off-balance sheet vehicles if you want to skirt liquidity regulation in the sense of making your loan-to-deposit ratio look low. The last variable of interest is gonna be reserves. Think of this as how the bank divides its funding between liquidity and loans. So on the liability side, what's going to be booked on balance sheet, so what the regulator will see, is the traditional deposits. So those have to be booked on balance sheet. And whatever deposit-like products the bank chooses to put on its balance sheet, the rest will go off balance sheet. On the asset side, the bank is going to hold reserves. It's going to have on-balance sheet loans and off-balance sheet loans. So the ability to move some activity off balance sheet is going to be a choice variable of the mix. So we set up the banking sector to be realistic in the sense that the purpose it serves is to provide a liquidity service. So it's going to take the funding it raises, it's going to invest in longer term projects, and in return offer savers something shorter term. So this is kind of the maturity transformation idea, that if the economy is endowed with a longer, define T equals 2 to be whatever horizon you'd like, the bank is basically going to create an asset that will pay more in the shorter term than what you can get if you invest in the longer term asset. Now, we're going to say that in terms of the interest rates that you can offer on deposits versus deposit-like products, we're going to allow for the possibility that deposit-like products pay a higher interest rate. They don't have to. So the bank could optimally set this psi equal to 0. If they do that, that means they're basically content offering only deposits. So there's no assumption that banks are going to finance themselves with both. That's going to be endogenously determined. Now, this type of, in order to introduce kind of an interbank market where banks are going to trade with each other, we're going to say that there are going to be withdrawal shocks that occur in the intermediate period. So some depositors might show up and some holders of these deposit-like products might show up to withdraw their funding. If you look at what's happening on the asset side of the bank, if they're just holding pure loans, the bank can't liquidate anything at T equals 1. So there's going to be a need for reserves, so a need for very liquid holdings in order to deal with the possibility that there's uncertainty on how much liquidity you're going to need in the intervening period. So in this environment, the government is going to impose what we're going to call a liquidity regulation, given that there's only two types of assets in the banks in our model. A liquidity regulation, basically the amount of reserves relative to the amount of on-balance sheet funding you have. The flip side of that is a loan-to-deposit regulation. So a floor on liquidity will be a ceiling on lending. So we're going to write this liquidity requirement as the ratio of reserves that you have to whatever funding the regulator sees on your balance sheet has to be greater than or equal to some lower bound alpha. So there's going to be a market where reserves get traded. There's an interest rate on this market, IL, which is going to be endogenously determined. And household savings, we're going to fix. So when we think about a credit boom in our model, basically what we're saying is that the total amount of credit is increasing relative to this fixed base of savings. So we're basically normalizing savings in the economy and thinking about what fraction of those savings become loans, either on or off balance sheet. So we're going to go through kind of two exercises. One is to think about a world where you only have small banks. So let's suppose, and what I mean by small banks is that these banks are going to take prices as given in the interbank market. So if you kind of remember, the interbank market is the market that you go to if you need emergency liquidity in this intermediate T equals one period. If you view yourself as being sufficiently small that your actions won't affect the prices on that market, then you're basically going to be a price taker on that market. So we're going to start with this case, and basically what we show in this case is that you will not get a credit boom if it's only small banks. So, this is the problem that the banks are going to solve. So at the initial date T equals zero, they're going to choose how much funding they want to attract in different forms, how much they want to move off balance sheet, and how they want to allocate their assets between liquid and illiquid to maximize their profits subject to this liquidity minimum. So, we write down a household optimization problem that's going to deliver demand functions from the households as a function of the interest rates that are being offered by the banking sector. Each bank, given that it views itself as being small relative to other banks, is going to take as given what other banks are doing. And the interbank market in equilibrium is going to clear so that the total amount of liquidity that's available is going to be equal to the total amount of liquidity that's demanded. All right, so in this environment, we're going to define something called the shadow cost of liquidity. Basically, this is, you can think of this, this IA term is the return on investing in this long-term asset, so the return on lending. IL is if you were to hold extra reserves, IL is what you could get from just lending them on the interbank market. If this thing is positive, so if you would earn more by investing in the long-term project than you would by lending on the interbank market, you would prefer to tilt your the assets on your balance sheet towards this long-term investment. So if the government comes in and imposes a liquidity regulation, it's effectively going to function as a tax for you. So how positive this new term, the shadow cost of liquidity regulation is going to be an indicator of how binding this liquidity constraint is. So what we're able to show is that this optimal choice, so this extra interest rate that you pay on these deposit-like products has two components. One is coming purely from competition, so it has nothing to do with regulation. In particular, so I'm just going to tell you this in words rather than going through the notation, if your operating costs are sufficiently small that you as a bank would like to get bigger, and you think that by offering higher returns on these products, so let me go back to the demand functions from the households. So if you think that you could potentially attract additional funding for yourself, so that's what this row term is, by offering attractive returns on these products and your operating costs are sufficiently small that you want to get bigger, then you'll offer these wealth management products, but they won't necessarily be off balance sheet. You'll just offer them on balance sheet. The other is the important term for us, which is the regulatory arbitrage mode. So in particular, if the shadow cost is positive, if kind of you really do want to lend more and earn this interest rate IA as opposed to keeping reserves on the interbank market, a liquidity rule is going to cause you to issue some of these deposit-like products, and in particular, issue them off balance sheet. Now, what you can show in this environment is that, so basically this will deliver shadow banking in the sense that if you impose a liquidity regulation that's sufficiently strict and sufficiently binding, you will have these banks offer off-balance sheet deposit-like products, which in the context of China is these off-balance sheet or principal floating wealth management products. The thing is, it doesn't really give you kind of the aggregate trends that you see in China. In particular, you don't see credit increase relative to the savings base. The intuition is going to be the following. So in a market equilibrium, the interest rate in the interbank market, so the interest rate that clears the interbank market, is going to be highest in the absence of government regulation. So suppose the government doesn't impose any liquidity minimum. If the interest rate on the interbank market is very low, then each individual bank is going to think that they don't need to hold their own liquidity. They can just borrow on the interbank market. That can't be an equilibrium. So if everybody thinks that way, there's going to be an insufficient amount of liquidity in the interbank market. So in the absence of government regulation, market forces are going to be such that the interest rate on the interbank market is very high in order to compel banks to hold their own liquidity. Okay? So liquidity holdings will therefore be high, which means credit will be credit is going to be low. So now what we're going to show is if you add a big bank, that's going to overturn this idea that introducing a liquidity minimum is going to substitute for some of this market discipline. So in the interest of time, let me just say that we're going to effectively extend the model in a parallel way to what we did. The only thing is we introduced this big bank. The difference between the big and the small bank is going to be that the big bank understands the effect of its decisions on kind of all other variables in the model. So the big bank is going to solve exactly the same problem as the small banks did before. The difference is twofold. So it's going to take into account the effect of its decisions on the behavior of the small banks. And it's also going to take into account the effect of its decisions on the interest rate in the interbank market. So here's kind of the main result of the paper. So under kind of very innocuous parameter conditions, you can show that small banks are going to have higher loan-to-deposit ratios. So the reason is that they don't internalize their effect on the interest rate in the interbank market. As a large bank, you know that if you hold a too small base of reserves, That's going to decrease the supply of reserves relative to demand, which is going to lead to a higher interbank rate and therefore increase your funding cost should you need to borrow reserves on the interbank market. Small banks don't take that into account, so they view themselves as too individually small in order to operate that mechanism. So as a result, they're going to be less liquid than the large banks in the system. So the first prediction of the model is going to be that small banks will have higher loan-to-deposit ratios than big banks. I'm going to show you that in China this was true. But this is sort of a general prediction of this model that is not calibrated to China in any way. So what that means is if you're going to introduce a loan-to-deposit cap in between the big and small banks, so this is going to be a differentially binding constraint, you're going to get a series of effects as listed here. So the first thing you're going to see is the emergence of these deposit-like products by both small and big banks. The difference is that the small banks are going to be going off balance sheet. The big banks are going to be issuing these products on balance sheet. The small banks are also going to be more aggressive in the sense of offering much higher returns than the big banks do, which is going to erode the funding share of the big banks. So if the small banks are offering higher interest rates on a certain set of products than the large banks are offering, household savings are going to migrate towards these higher return products away from whatever it is that the big banks are offering. So what we argue is that the big bank is going to respond to this. So one way that it responds is by issuing its own products. The other way that it responds is by using the interbank market. So if you go back to this spread that I defined, the shadow cost of liquidity, the interest rate in the interbank market is important for determining how much of a tax the liquidity regulation is on the banks. So if the interbank rate is very low, then it's a huge cost for the banks to have to comply with liquidity regulation. So their incentives to go off balance sheet are very strong. So the big bank, given that it's a price setter on the interbank market, can basically hold fewer reserves, decrease the supply of liquidity that's available, increase the price of emergency liquidity, and erode the shadow cost so that small banks have less of an incentive to go off balance sheet. So basically what we argue is that the big bank has kind of a strategic response, 3 minutes, okay. A strategic response that is going to lead to a tighter interbank market. It's also going to directly increase credit. So the big banks, basically, they're going to take away liquidity from the interbank market. Instead of sitting on it idly, they're going to lend it to their usual borrowers. You're also going to get another kick to credit, which is a compositional effect. So as savings are going to migrate from big banks to small banks, remember, because the small banks are being more aggressive than the big banks, so the funding share of the big banks is going to fall. You're going to move, the marginal dollar of savings is going to move from banks that have lower loan-to-deposit ratios to banks that have higher loan-to-deposit ratios. The last prediction is that the on-balance sheet loan-to-deposit ratios of large and small banks are going to converge. So let me show you, I guess in my last 2 minutes, some stuff about China. So China begins raising liquidity standards in 2008. So this is implemented as a 75% loan to deposit cap, which has been there since before 2008, but it only starts being strictly enforced in 2008. More importantly, it's the frequency of enforcement increases over time. So it's initially enforced as an end of year ratio, then as an end of quarter, then as an end of month, and eventually it's based on average balance. So shadow banking in China emerges, and you saw some of these facts in the previous presentation. The interest rates in the interbank market also increase, and credit increases. If you do kind of a simple money multiplier calculation to figure out how much of this increase in credit can be attributable to the fiscal stimulus package, you get that about 40% of it can be attributed, so there's still something that needs to be explained. So we want to see how much of this residual our mechanism can explain. So in terms of cross-sectional facts, we can basically show, so I won't go through all of this, but the predictions of the model on the cross-sectional basis are borne out in the data. So both big and small banks start offering the wealth management products, which map into the deposit-like products in our model. Small banks are more aggressive in the sense that they offer more off-balance sheet, and they also offer higher returns than big banks do. If you do Granger causality tests, you find that small banks are the drivers of the patterns in wealth management product issuance relative to big banks. All right, so Zhiguo showed you the best graph that he's ever come up with. This is the best graph I've ever come up with. So here are the loan-to-deposit ratios of the big four banks in blue and the joint stock banks in red. Importantly, the solid lines are showing you loan-to-deposit ratios based on end-of-year balances. The dotted lines are showing you loan-to-deposit ratios based on average balances during the year. So this idea that there's going to be a convergence in the loan-to-deposit ratios, you see in both cases. The thing that you notice is that in terms of the loan-to-deposit ratios of these joint stock banks, which are essentially the small banks in our model, they're window dressing their balance sheets relative to their true position during the year. Now, the reason this is significant is as the regulator is increasing the frequency of loan-to-deposit ratios, over the course of 2.5 years, going from end-of-year ratios to average balances during the year. So the tightening of regulation, so this is sort of why I would argue that loan-to-deposit regulation is kind of just as important, if not more important, than the fiscal stimulus story. Even if you didn't have fiscal stimulus and you look at the loan-to-deposit ratios of the joint stock banks in 2007, loan-to-deposit regulation would have been a binding constraint on them, regardless of kind of Bank of China taking deposits and removing market share from these guys. So loan-to-deposit regulation on its own, when you look at the average balance data, which is not window-dressed and reflects the true position of the banks, tells you that a constraint on them, a 75% constraint on them, that would be applied to average balance data would have, in fact, bound on that. All right, so this one I probably don't have a lot of time to talk about. So this was just showing what Zhiguo had mentioned, that the timing of the wealth management products to mature at the end of or basically whenever it is that the regulator would show up to check. So you see this for smaller banks, you do not see it for bigger banks. Very quickly I'll mention two more things. So if you look at what happens to the big four, so you notice an increase in the big four loan-to-deposit ratio. We can purge out the effects of the stimulus package. So in terms of how much financing for the stimulus package came from the big four, you get that, so this trend, instead of going from kind of 0.6 to 0.7, it'll go from 0.6 to 0.67. So there's still an increase in the aggressiveness of lending by the big four, even removing their funding of the stimulus package. So there's something else that's going on over and above the stimulus package. Okay, this I probably don't have a lot of time to talk about, but we got transactions level data on the interbank market to show that the big four are indeed setting prices on this market in a way that disadvantages their smaller competitors. The last thing is the calibration. So we take this model to the data. We show that this is basically the table that's going to show you. We match moments pretty well. We explain about half of the trends in the interbank rate, a third of the increase in credit to savings. We do kind of a variance decomposition of shocks. We find that shocks to liquidity regulation relative to shocks to demand, or shocks to money supply are important in explaining correlations in the data. All right, so that's it. Thank you.
Hui Chen from MIT.
So you have two choices. Oh, but make sure it's on.
Organizers for inviting me to discuss this paper. I'm by no means a banking expert, but a couple months ago, actually, I discussed a somewhat related paper about, again, wealth management products in China and the Chinese economy, MBR. And I got more and more interested in this topic. And this definitely is one of the very high quality papers showing to think about this issue very seriously. And in particular, you know, you probably can tell that this is probably not the simplest two-peer model you have seen in your life. Yet, I would very much recommend everybody to take a second to think, read through the paper, because Kinda and her co-author actually did a fantastic job trying to explain what the intuition behind the economic theoretical results are. So I very much recommend you to read it. So let me actually sort of reveal a little bit of what is the punchline of the model. The punchline essentially can be pretty simply summarized. Is this theoretical result mainly, and then it's applied empirically to the China setting. The theoretical result basically says that if you tighten the reserve requirements, it's going to have a potentially very severe and very unintuitive, in a sense, consequence, unintended consequence, hence the word, about leading to a credit boom. Okay? So if you're looking at this statement at the first time, you'll be scratching your head. What do you mean? Like, this sounds very much counterintuitive. But how it comes about is basically the following. It's a combination of two effects. One is this regulatory arbitrage that Kinder has been talking about, as well as these big banks using the interbank lending channel. So as Zhiguo mentioned, the Chinese interbank market is pretty complicated. For this paper's purpose, we're focusing on the interbank lending market, how basically reserves are being managed and lent out. Now, this paper actually goes beyond the theory. That's, in fact, making the paper even more interesting. They provided some evidence, nonetheless, you know, somewhat anecdotal in nature, but the evidence nonetheless, trying to point to evidence supporting this claim that the big banks are engaging or exerting their market power in this interbank market, which I think is very important. And the second part is that they are pretty ambitious in applying this model, calibrating seriously, and trying to explain how much this particular channel can account for the credit boom. In particular, they found that about a third of the credit boom, so the not separate from these stimulus, actually can account for the data. So now, since it's a theory paper primarily, I'm going to try to actually flesh out what actually the economic intuition is. I'm going to simplify the notation somewhat so that it's hopefully a bit more bearable and use more words as well. So as I mentioned, there are really two parts. So pay attention. One is the regulatory arbitrage component. The other one is this interbank market power by the big banks. So let's look at the first one first. So basically now thinking about the small banks, how are they deciding on their interest rate for these wealth management products? And how can they respond to, for example, a rising reserve requirement? So first of all, as I mentioned, there is this reserve requirement, which basically says that your reserve has to be at least as constant proportion of the the reserve requirement has to exceed the constant proportion of your on the balance sheet deposits. So this is your total funding minus this wealth management asset or wealth management product part. The residual part is your on balance sheet deposit, and that part is subject to this reserve requirement. So later on, we're going to try to change this alpha and think about through the consequence of that. And then the banks can banks face this shadow cost of reserve. So for every dollar reserve you hold, you can earn this reserve rate, I of L, but you lose the opportunity to invest. And in the model, we're assuming that the investment or return from making these loans to, say, non-financial firms, or maybe investing in other parts of the markets, actually offer you a higher rate than the reserve rate that you can earn from the interbank lending market. So that basically constitutes a shadow cost for holding these reserves. And that's basically the source of the regulatory arbitrage. So there's actually a simple way to think about how is this incentive to basically jack up your offering interest rate for these deposit-like products in response to this regulatory arbitrage. For example, if the interest rate spread between the return you can earn on your assets versus the interest rate you can earn on the reserves is large, this gap is large, then you have more incentive to increase the interest rate on the deposit-like products. Alternatively, if you're facing high reserve requirement, alpha is high, then you would also have incentive to increase your interest on the products. And that was exactly the kind of channel that Ginda and Zheng are focusing on. All right, so that's the first part, and it's kind of the easy part, and that's kind of the more standard part. The second part has to do with the big banks. By the way, there's a quick sort of a note here. You know, at this point, we're really not mentioning risks at all, and as QJ and Zhiguo alluded to, there is actually kind of non-trivial game played by the participants in this market about, you know, trying to convince the investors that this is risk-free, but yet, you know, probably the majority of investors recognize the fact that even though there's implicit government guarantee, it's not the, you know, explicit guarantees. That's a big difference. So as a result, you can sort of think about, you know, if these deposit products are offering higher interest rate, why don't everybody go to them? Well, in the model, it's because there's some adjustment cost or transaction cost associated with it. But in reality, I think they potentially have some story to be told about what exactly these transaction costs are. And I'm going to come back to that point a little later on. All right, so now in terms of the key elements of the second part, which is a really interesting part of the theory, it's about this market power of these big banks. So the big banks basically are, you know, taking into account their market power and market impact on this interbank lending rate. And one of the effects of that is actually that because of that, because they internalize that effect, they have a lower propensity actually to lend out of their funds. So that makes this actually funding share between big banks and small banks kind of a crucial component to determine the credit boom later on. But in terms of thinking about the incentive for the big banks to influence this interest rate, there are actually three sort of different channels here. The first one is pretty straightforward. If you have more reserves, then, you know, offering a higher rate means that you can earn more from the reserves. So that's kind of direct. The second channel has to do with the fact that if changing the interbank lending rate can actually lead the big banks to hold less reserve, which in a way kind of sounds surprising, but actually has to do with the fact that higher interest rates actually lead the central banks to step in to provide more liquidity in the interbank market. And also, high interest rate, as you can see later, actually discourages the small banks from engaging too much off-balance sheet activity. So that actually potentially in the model could lead back big banks to hold less reserve, and that actually reduced the shadow cost of reserve. So that's kind of the second channel. But the real important one here is actually the funding share motive. I was actually already alluding to, is that by, you know, increasing the spread between small banks are facing between the returns on their lending activity versus the return on the reserves, reducing it, you actually discourage the small banks from engaging too much off-balance sheet activity. And that was kind of the crucial channel there in driving the small banks from, you know, engaging too much of off-balance sheet transformation. All right, so now those elements are in place. Now let's think about what's going to happen when, let's say, government increases the reserve requirement. Well, what's going to happen is that, first of all, small banks are having stronger motive to engage in regulatory arbitrage, as I just explained in the first part. So what they do is they're going to increase these rates they offer on the wealth management products. They are, you know, the part of the off-balance sheet, part of their sort of the bank is going to become bigger. Their funding share would also become bigger, and that leads to more lending from the small banks. The big banks are not going to stand still. They're going to react. How do they react? They react by directly competing. So they start offering wealth management products as well, although at a lower rate. But also, they're going to try to sort of slow down those small banks through this interbank channel. And the way they do that is basically withdraw their liquidity supply in the interbank market, raising that interbank lending rate, and as a result, closing the gap between the sort of the profit margin, if you want, of the regulatory arbitrage. That's the basic argument behind this model, if you want to summarize in, you know, one sentence. So that's basically what's going on. But the end result, of course, is that the big banks are still losing market share or funding share to the small banks. And that was why, in the end, and remember, the propensity for the small banks to lend is higher. So as a result, you actually get this credit boom coming out of the increase in the capital requirement, reserve requirement, rather. Okay, so that's essentially the point of the theory. So let me quickly comment on some pieces of the model first, and then I'm actually going to provide a little bit of wish list for how do you really drive home the argument of the model. So first of all, as I pointed out earlier, the small banks, when they increase the interest rate on the deposit-like products, in the model at least, there's somewhat mechanical link between that and the funding share. So remember that the whole point is that the small banks really don't want to put too much of their funding on the balance sheet. And in response to the higher reserve requirement, they want to shift it off the balance sheet. But the only way for the small banks in this model, at least, to do that is to increase the interest rate on the deposit-like products. There's not really a sort of intensive margin there because you can't really just fix your funding share, just do the transformation internally, right? Remember that the interest rate cap is sort of capped above, but presumably there are other channels that the small banks can use to, without directly affecting the funding share themselves, shifting the deposit just off the balance sheet that way. I care about this point because I think about the sort of quantitative effects there. This could potentially lead us to, by binding these together, it could potentially lead us to overstate the effects of this channel. This is more of a quantitative point. The second point is what I alluded to earlier, was about how do you think about this transaction cost of deposit-like products. So just to give you an example, right? So we sort of hinted at maybe the reason that the households are splitting their money between the regular deposit and this wealth management product is because they are aware that these are not fully guaranteed. Well, in which case, then this risk actually is going to be behind this omega parameter, this quote-unquote transaction cost. Why is that important? Because now you think about why are these regulatory agencies, or in particular the central bank, aggressively changing these reserve requirements? Presumably for a good reason, I guess. Because they're starting to worry about the funding adequacy of these small banks, or and large banks for that matter. And that probably is related to the underlying risks of the economy, and in particular with this wealth management products. So in that sense, now we get the correlation between these two, which again, for quantitative purpose, it becomes really relevant. So that's something I think I would like the authors think about more. And then finally, we're talking about pretty large-scale credit boom. Remember, this paper is claiming that it's explaining about a third of the credit boom in China, which is huge. And at some point, you start wondering, for this kind of scale of credit boom, what is the general equilibrium effect, right? We are holding, for example, the interest rate or the return on the lending fixed here, which to an extent is fine. But at some point, we start thinking about credit boom actually leads to sort of an oversupply, quote unquote, of credit that leads to actually, quote unquote, cheap credit. But that would then actually partially offset the result in the end. So that, again, is a quantitative point, but nonetheless, a relevant one we assess the importance of this channel. So that's on the model side. Then let me give you a little bit of wish list. I think even though it might be somewhat hard to get, but nonetheless, if you can get them, I think I can really drive home the point. The first one is, if you think about the intuition behind the main theoretical argument, we really need two pieces, right? So we need the small banks to care about this interbank rate, meaning that you want to look for some kind of large sensitivity of the small bank decisions on interest rate, on their funding share, when interbank rates are changing. That's one piece of the puzzle. The second piece is basically we want to find evidence of big banks actually having and exerting market power in this interbank lending market. This in the paper, actually, there is a little bit of evidence towards this. We can comment on a little bit. But I think actually one thing that could be potentially utilized is thinking about this sort of a bank liquidity crisis in 2013, which the paper actually used on. Perhaps think about a sort of a diff kind of exercise. Think about how small banks essentially abuse this if the story is true that the big banks are essentially actively withdrawing credit and causing the bank interbank lending rates to spike, as opposed to being caught by the crisis themselves, then their response afterwards actually could be very different, right? Basically, the small banks got a lesson from this shock, and they should respond by, wait a second, I should really be more cautious and hold on more reserves from this point on. Whereas the big banks, because they manufacture the quote-unquote, they would then react very differently. So maybe some kind of different if exercise could lead to more support to the theory that's being laid out here. Another point I think is kind of interesting to think about is the model is kind of static, so you can't really distinguish between having high interbank lending rates for extended period of time versus this sharp spikes in interbank rates, which we actually saw in the data. That actually has a pretty important dynamic implications. So again, that's something potentially to think about. And then finally, if you want to apply these arguments to, say, US market, there we actually know that the market structure is very different. For example, there are some papers related that studying this Fed funds market that pointed out that in the US market, small banks are exactly doing the opposite. They're actually the net lenders. And also, there are some strong evidence suggesting that this stable customer relation, the borrowing relationships, are very vital for this market in the US. So in particular, when there is a crisis, a liquidity crisis like hitting the market, these lenders actually keep their interest rate low as opposed to jack up the rates because they are providing an insurance service. Anyway, that's something to potentially look out for when you want to apply this to the US market. Because this, I'm short on time, actually, I mean, just quickly sort of zero on one last point is about the regulator. So because we're applying this to China, I think this point is particularly relevant. We want to think about essentially what exactly is the role of the government here, which in the model is being made kind of the passive. So the government does have this role of supplying additional liquidity into the interbank market when they see higher interest rates. But they're doing this in a very mechanical fashion. There's sort of two points here. One is if you think of it like as a positive point, just trying to describe the kind of behavior of the government or the central bank in supplying liquidity, and being this intensity to supply liquidity or willingness to supply liquidity as a shock, then you can potentially disentangle this alternative story, which is that the central bank is trying to use the interbank market to discipline the off-balance sheet activities, right? So if you guys are being too aggressive, then even though you're anticipating me to supplying extra liquidity when liquidity is drying up, this time I'm going to stop from doing that, and then everybody gets a huge shock, and from that point on, everybody behave more as expected. That's alternative story, and the authors actually try to disentangle that, but I think potentially can be used as an alternative and be entertained as well in the quantitative exercise. And second thing is that is more of a normative point, which is if you are the regulator, recognizing the fact as being laid out in this paper, theoretical point, which is that these regulatory arbitrage combined with its interbank channel are at play, then how would you actually do it differently, right? As opposed to just blindly raising the reserve requirement, let's give them a little bit more policy tools, such as maybe introducing a reserve requirement on these other products, maybe changing your liquidity supply policy. How would you be able to design a better policy to try to sort of offset these kind of unintended consequences? So that's all I have. So basically, I would very much recommend you to read the paper, and I think it has made a pretty profound and not obvious point about the interbank market and its impact on the credit supply. Thank you.
Yeah, this is a very interesting paper, and it takes me back 45 years to when I was a young economist in the International Finance Division of the Board of Governors, and a major financial process that was taking place at the time was the growth of the Eurodollar market, in which U.S. banks would issue deposits outside the U.S., borrow the proceeds back, and they would not be subject to reserve requirements, which domestic deposits were. And so it had many of the flavors of the same thing that's happening here. But I argued, and my University of Chicago PhD colleagues argued even more strenuously, that Arthur Burns could not use the Eurodollar market for an excuse of loss of control of the money supply and credit, and that they had the tools to raise interest rates to a level that would have choked off this boom if they had wanted to use them. And I think the same thing is true with the PBOC in China, and I think it's a misleading way of using the model, and I'm not quite sure what ceteris paribus assumptions are being made. But buried in that has to be one that the central bank isn't able to achieve its objective of controlling credit in the economy. And I think even in this model, that can't be true.
Okay, so the implicit assumption that's being made is that the PBOC doesn't operate in the same way that, let's say, the Fed does in terms of targeting an interest rate on the interbank market. So that's what opens the door for the Big Four to occasionally change interbank conditions. So, I mean, I don't think it's misleading in any sense. It's just, we say this.
Letting them off the hook.
So we say this in the paper, that as long as you have as long as the central bank is not constantly intervening to achieve a target in the interbank market, there will be variations in the interbank rate that could be engineered by large players in this market. And, I mean, historically, I think when the Fed was not targeting interest rates, in principle it was possible. I guess the difference is that because there weren't capital controls at the time, one of the issues in China is that the reason the Big Four have this sort of market power is the small banks don't really have anywhere to turn. So it's that combination of everywhere you go in an interbank market in China, you run into the Big Four, and the government isn't constantly offsetting what they do that opens the door. But yeah, I mean, I agree with the point that if the government were to change the operating procedure and target the interbank rate, then, I mean, we could introduce this. So we have like a variable for external liquidity. I think we showed it and I had to skip over it, but there is a parameter for external liquidity that we could use. And when we ran that, basically you find that the big banks start to behave a lot more than the small banks, a lot more like the small banks, and shadow banking is a lot bigger than it is with this kind of disciplining device. And since I said this, let me just answer one question, which is, we did the quantitative part where we say, okay, is it possible that the government is disciplining the market by kind of changing conditions? And basically what we find is that if that's the story, then you can't match correlations between interest rates and returns on wealth management products. So a lot of the variation in the interbank rate and matching the correlations between different types of spreads, it really relies on, this is not we're imposing, but the estimation results say that variations in liquidity regulation are more important than variations in central bank injection of liquidity. So we do have that at the very end, but.
So I'm offering you an argument to see why people don't buy. This is not the transaction cost. The transaction cost is not the story here. The cost is actually the wealth management product, which I have data here. 85% of them requires a threshold. You have to buy 50,000 is the minimum you can buy. 12% of them actually requires 100,000. And then another 3% is ₥1 million. So why the wealth management product has this threshold, minimum threshold, is because of regulators say these are higher risk. They want people with, better financially able person to buy this type of things. It's actually very little risk, as Qian Jun once mentioned, right? There's no risk at all, but they want this. They actually require the block. You have to have at least 50,000 to buy. So that's why not many people do this type. There's lots of them, but not enough. There's the cost of that's not a transaction cost story. Okay.
Yeah. That also goes back to the U.S. in the 70s.
That's also the. Okay.
So in the previous paper, as well as this paper, we focus on this loan-to-deposit ratio. That's one of the binding constraints. But there are a number of other binding constraints. And I think this doesn't invalidate the model, but when we take it to data, especially around 08, for example, the reserve required ratio was lower from 17.5 to 15.5 and 13.5 for small, medium bank versus big banks. I think that's actually working in favor of your theory, but is that something that that's possible to incorporate or discuss in this context?
So, I mean, the way that we think about it is, the reserve requirement is a more specific type of liquidity regulation than the loan-to-deposit ratio. So if you think about how you would, in an abstract way, divide the assets of a bank, you have reserves, then you have like liquid securities that could be used to get cash if you need it, and then you have loans. So basically what the enforcement of the 75% loan-to-deposit cap is saying is that if you have a decrease in reserve requirements but a stringent 75% cap, it means that the banks have more flexibility in what form they want to hold their liquidity, but they still have to satisfy the 75% cap. So in that sense, broadly defined liquidity regulation is still getting stronger even with this decrease in reserve requirement. It just, there's a little bit of reprieve in terms of when you decrease from 17 to 14.
It's a differential decrease for small banks versus large
banks. I mean, that's fine, but it's just a matter of you can substitute between like central bank, from reserves to central bank bills, but the 75% cap is still there. So you can't increase your lending because of this change in reserve requirement. So in that sense, it's still a more stringent liquidity regulation in that you have to hold more liquidity than you were before, but it's maybe giving you, in the intensive margin, more flexibility in terms of what form you hold your liquidity in. Okay, so as for the I wasn't really sure if there was a question in there, but...
You mentioned this as a transaction cost. That's a convenient. The story is not transaction cost. The story is... The story is a household, actually, it's a supply side story. It's not demand side story. It's not that they have transaction move back and forth.
But so, I mean, we're not saying a transaction's cost. We're just saying that the reason that you don't so you're saying that the reason they don't automatically switch from deposits to wealth management products, like with a slight increase in the interest rate, is because you have a minimum investment.
Yeah.
I mean, that's fine. I guess the question is, if we incorporated that in the model, I'm not sure the economics would change. It's just we'd have a threshold, and we'd have to move the thresholds around.
I'm saying just when you motivate this part, that's not. Transaction cost is not the story to motivate.
I mean, that part is in the appendix, but sure.
Consider indivisibility like that.
Yes, as this discussant suggested, the disciplining mechanism you get here from the big banks is stronger in your model because there's one big bank. And I'm wondering, you know, to what extent are we to think that, you know, the reality in China is more like there's one big bank? In particular, is it the case that interbank lending, there's something like relationship banking, so that smaller banks typically borrow from the same single bank, so you might get more of a monopolistic solution? Or is it more like a oligopoly situation where the mechanism might not be so strong?
Okay, so I kind of make two comments on that. So the first is I didn't have a lot of time to talk about this, but we got a month's worth of interbank transactions data, and around this like event in 2013. So we can see the pricing by individual members in the Big Four versus the pricing by policy banks or the pricing by joint stock banks. We don't know the names of the individual bank, but we have like numbers that tell us whether it's a Big Four or a joint stock bank. So you see a lot less dispersion in the prices that are amongst the Big Four than amongst any other set, like even amongst the three policy banks or amongst the joint stock banks or city and commercial banks. So there is a sense in which they're more uniform in their pricing, which, I mean, exactly. Now, in the model, we do it with a monopolist. So we did a version where we had two. It quantitatively, it'll decrease the impact, but the impact is still there. I mean, so as long as there's some form of, there's two large players that recognize that if they kind of team up together in this way, then they're basically going to, as a whole, increase their market share relative to what it would have otherwise been. The story still goes through. But yeah, quantitatively, it'll be a little bit weaker.
So I guess I can add on that point as well. I guess I didn't have time to make that point, but if you think about this collusion story, right, basically when the spread in the rates that the Big Four are offering are become less dispersed. But how would you be able to rule out, for example, these big banks are experiencing common liquidity shocks as opposed to, you know, being idiosyncratic as your model would be assuming? That's going to be kind of hard to do some time.
I mean, so one thing that I would say on that point, but yes, we would have to think about this, but there is a fair amount of trading from one big bank to another. So if you thought that they were experiencing kind of common liquidity shocks, they should always be either on the lending side or on the borrowing side. But you do see a fair amount of like lending from one big bank to another big bank, which would suggest that maybe, I mean, there's some risk sharing that's going on in between them. So that might be one way to get at that point. I mean, the other is sort of the narrative, which is, I mean, I feel like Michael would have a lot more credibility saying this, but this is what he tells me, so I'm just going to quote him, that the government kind of tells the Big Four not to compete too heavily against each other, and they were sort of set up in that way. I mean, so they kind of divided, so one is foreign exchange, one is agriculture. So there's a sense in which they're not kind of trying to step on each other's toes. And it sort of makes sense given that the head regulator is chosen from the heads of the Big Four banks. So if this is a repeated game, then strategically you may not want to step on the toes of the other Big Four, whereas you're willing to do it with the small bank. So, I mean, you can tell a political economy story, but